everybody, thanks for coming. We had a little not a money bet, but we were betting how many people would come, and I think I won, so thanks so much. I'm Sarah Woodbury, the library director, and it's really exciting to have you all here to, so we can show you what the committee has been doing for, well, it's at least a year and a half. But before that, there was a lot of groundwork that was done, studies and so forth. So anyway, what I'm going to do is just start out by introducing the committee, and if you put those names up there, so that will remind me of everybody. This is Daniel Pallotta. He's our OPM, that stands for Owner's Project Manager. He is required by the state law to be present and to provide his services for any kind of construction program.
You're halfway there.
Okay. Nancy Maynard, the chair of the trustees, was not able to be here. She was going to be here on Monday night, but she had a scheduling conflict. Dave Lamb, our vice chair, will give a few remarks in a second or so. Cynthia Von Flatern is our trustee secretary. I don't think she's here. Grant Bialik. He serves as the treasurer for the Tilton Fund, which is a tax exempt organization for the trustees. Elsie is not here. Kolakowski is not here tonight. Kathy O'Rourke, Sharon Pachorik, Bette Schmidt, and Satu Zoller. Satu and Dave serve as the committee, the representatives for the trustees on the committee. And the Space Needs Committee really has another longer name. It's Dave Lamb is the co-chair along with Judy Holmes, who's over here. Candace Bradbury Carlin over here. Mark Gilmore, our selectman, as you know. Ralph Healy from the Finance Committee, Ralph. Liz Libby was not able to be here tonight because of the scheduling change. And Satu, again, and me. So Dave has a few remarks from Nancy that he's going to read.
Yeah, Nancy is the chair of the library trustees, was unable to be here because of other business commitments. She had to be in New York City. So I'm going to be Nancy tonight reading her little address for you. Okay, so she said, good evening. On behalf of the Board of Trustees, and this is a mouthful, the subcommittee of the Board Needs Assessment Ad Hoc Committee. That's this group right here. And the patrons of the Tilton Library, I'm pleased to welcome you tonight to this very important Library Improvement Project Community Meeting. The goal of this meeting is to educate the community on library activities. Those of us who have been involved with the oversight of the library came to the conclusion back in the fall of 2013 that we should apply for a planning and design grant from the Mass Board of Library Commissioners to consider next steps for the library. Because of our previous work with developing five-year plans for the library, the discussion about library expansion has been on the minds of the trustees, library directors, and patrons for many years. In September 2014, we received a notification that our application for a planning and design grant had been approved. We were awarded $41,205, and the Tilton Fund of the library contributed $20,600. The board voted with the selectmen's approval to develop a subcommittee. The committee composition includes two trustee members, two members of the Friends, members from town finance and town selectmen, a former teacher, a library user, and the librarian. This committee has been truly amazing, spending countless hours, evenings, and weekends visiting libraries all over Massachusetts and discussing the library needs and what would best meet the community needs for our library. I want to publicly thank the committee on behalf of the Board of Trustees for their dedication and hard work to get to this point in the process. Sarah, our librarian, thank you for your steadfast guidance in working with this committee. We are glad to have welcomed Daniel Pallotta as our OPM and Johnson Roberts Associates as our designer. The committee has moved from visitations and discussion to hiring an OPM and now an architect to oversee the project. The process we are following is one that is designed by the MBLC. Throughout this time, the committee has kept the board and selectmen at various meetings apprised of the accomplishment and decision points. As we move through this phase, we will be preparing for the next application, which will be due in January 2017. What we know is that the library will be celebrating its 100th anniversary this fall. It is one of the most distinctive focal points of the town. Its location is easy for all who like to use the library, so tonight's meeting is our way to share with you the plans to date, and most importantly, to hear from you as interested town residents and dedicated patrons of the library. Please join me in this evening in listening to where we are and help us determine the next steps.
Okay.
And there's some seats over there too.
I wanted to add one additional. I'm Judy Holmes. I am the president of the Friends, and I am the co-chair of this ad hoc space, whatever it is.
It's a long name.
We have a lot of names. Phil O'Brien is the architect here today from Johnson Roberts, and just wonderful. It's been a pleasure working with him. You'll hear from him in a little bit. I just wanted to tell you a little bit about what our committee has done to get us to this point. After being appointed and sworn in by the town clerk, we met several times. Our first point of business was to educate ourselves. About the process. Sarah, of course, knows a great deal about everything, but she had to bring us up to snuff. And we toured, I think, about a dozen libraries, some of which have been renovations and some of which have been brand new buildings. And we met with the librarians and we got to ask questions about their own process of working with the architects. And now that their buildings were built, what do they wish they had done differently? We've just collected a wealth of information by going to these different libraries and talking to them and seeing what a modern library does today. And then we would come back home to our beloved Tilton and we'd say, wow, we need more space. I think the fact that this meeting is here in this room is a testament to the fact that we need more space in town. So that was our first task, was to go to other libraries and see what the possibilities were. And then to bring that back to the library and to think about what our specific needs were. We also surveyed town residents at an election. I was trying to remember which one it was, but I think it was a spring election. We had a little table outside of the polling place over in Town Hall, and we just had a little quick survey. Do you use the library? If so, what do you like about it? If you don't, what would you like to see about it? Just to sort of collect some data. And not necessarily from library patrons, but people who were going back and forth to vote. And the overwhelming majority of people said, we love the library and it needs more space. And we sometimes find that we have to travel to other towns to do things because our own library isn't capable of providing some of the services that we would like to see here in our town. So that was very satisfying, but it was very positive and real spur to us to keep going with our project. We interviewed several candidates for the OPM job and decided on Dan Flotta. And then along with Dan's help, we interviewed several architects and decided on Johnson Roberts, and been very happy with both of those decisions. But that took some time, as those of you who have been involved in hiring processes know. After we got everything was in place, then we started working with the designers to create a schematic. When this application grant goes into the Mass Board of Library Commissioners, we have to have a schematic of what we're envisioning we would do with the money that we got. After several meetings, this is the result of that, and we're going to walk you through that schematic a little bit later in the presentation. But the schematic is sort of our vision of what we could do if the stars align themselves properly and everything goes through as we hope. So I think that that um, uh, At this point, we really are trying to get as much information as we can out to the town and to share with the town what we've learned in this process and how excited we are about the possibilities that are ahead. But understanding that there's still, a lot of decisions to be made. And this meeting tonight is really a progress report about this is where we are and this is where we're going. And then hopefully we'll be able to get some your feedback at the end. And then, I think that's it. So next up is Sipra, I believe.
I just want to make one thing clear. I don't know everything. I don't know a lot. I'm a know-it-all. I know where to find things, so not to correct my elders or anything. So this looks like Judy's slide. I'm speaking about the Mass Board of Library Commissioners, which is a state agency that has many functions. What it does is it's a board appointed by the governor, but it also, there's 25 staff members, and they do things such as advocacy, grants, a summer reading program, they do education, they have a lot of functions as far as libraries go in the state of Massachusetts. What we're interested in tonight is their grant. They have three main important grants, state aid, which we benefit from, the library service and technology grants, which are federal grants, which we have actually received in the past, and the public library construction grant. The public library construction grant is the guidelines for it are this document called CMR 600 something. And it outlines exactly what you have to do for this grant. And one of the things, and we'll hear more about that when I talk about the library building program. So MBLC, they are the people who are going to give us this grant and help us get an improved library for the town of Deerfield.
I'll do the construction if you want. I don't know.
Yeah, you're next.
Yeah, that's right.
Yep.
Construction grant. The process is pretty difficult. There's a whole document we have to go through. One of the important things that we have to do is we have to design the library, which we're going to get into where we are in the design in a little bit. But the grant program is broken into two parts, a planning grant, which you've received, and a construction grant. And the way the construction grant works is they do this about every 8 to 10 years, they run a construction grant program. We're right perfect for the cycle for Deerfield to get the grant. But we don't know when we'll get the grant, and that won't be announced until the summer of 2017. The town will have to vote to apply for the grant. And then the town will have to appropriate to receive the grant. So the grant won't be the full amount that you of your construction. It'll be approximately 45% to 50%, probably closer to 50% in this library. So we'll have all those numbers when it's time to do the second vote. We're not at that point yet with the design. But on the first part, in September, there'll be what's called grant seminars, and it's a requirement of the grant program that Sarah goes to a grant seminar, as well as the design team and the OPM. So we'll all be going to a grant seminar, which will be held all over the state, because the grant rules change a little bit with each 8 to 10 year cycle. The grant round is going in January. A notice of intent will be going in this June. So this June, we're gonna send in the notice of intent that we intend to apply for a grant. And the Library Commissioners already know we're working on the grant because we actually work with the Library Commissioner's staff. They've come out here 2 or 3 times already, and I think they'll be out here probably within the next couple of weeks again. So the grant program is pretty straightforward, and it's a needs-based grant. If you check off all the boxes, you're going to get a grant, but you're going to get funded by needs. So in the first year, there'll be 5 or 6 libraries throughout the state funded. In the second year, there'll be 5 or 6 libraries funded. In the third year, there'll be 5 or 6, and so on and so forth, till the library with the lowest need gets funded in that grant cycle. This guy right here, puts together most of the important stuff, and he's 35 for 35. So he's applied for 35 grants, and he's received 35 grants. And he's promising us we're not going to go 35 for 36. So we're pretty excited about that.
This is Dan.
Yeah.
Ralph.
My name is Ralph Healy, and I'm on the Needs Assessment Committee. And before I get quite into this, I'd like to just say that we as a town are very fortunate to have the Board of Trustees that the library has here. When you read some of the things that have been done down to the red line here, all of that would not have occurred without the board and the library staff working diligently at it. I think we take a lot for granted things just sort of happen, but they don't. There's a lot of hard work, a lot of dedication to get to that point. As you can see, the letter of intent, apply for the design grant, approval of the design grant, develop a library building program, develop the project team, the OPM designer. Those are just short, quick words, but behind it, there's an awful lot of effort and an awful lot of desire to do the right thing for this town. We're now at the design refinement, and that's exactly where we're at this point. And this is where you and all your neighbors and friends need to really step forward and get involved, because we're starting to fine-tune this, and this library is not about just the trustees or the staff. It's about the town and our needs and what we want and how we want to do it. So with the opportunity tonight to speak, I'd like to just make sure that you really think about that. Give up a few minutes of your time if you can and get people involved to step forward and look things over and give their input. Because when it's all said and done, it's not about what these gentlemen feel is a good design. It's about what we need, what we really want as a town, because every library is unique to its town. We'll be, of course, going forward with a schematic design, the construction grant application, the grant approval, obtaining funding and town approval, construction, and new library needs. And I point out the obtained funding. Of course, life is always about money, and it's really the key thing. If we can obtain this grant, it's a big, big chunk to getting to where we really need to go. Obviously, this library's had needs for many, many years. I felt very good when they had that little survey here recently in the last year or two, to see the number of people in town, people I never dreamed would stop by with interest. And I think there is a real desire by this town, by a lot of quiet people out there, to get this done. And it is going to take town funding, it's going to take donations, it's going to take a lot of effort on everybody's behalf. But I encourage you to think about that and keep pushing on. I'm absolutely positive it can be done. I know it's a hard time in everybody's life right now, and particularly in the towns, but I think that the desire is here. I think it's a tremendous thing for this town, and I encourage us all to get behind it. Hopefully, we'll be here again soon, and we'll be opening the new library. Thank you.
Okay, the next steps that we're going to do after we get all the questions from the public and the public's had time to review it and we tweak the drawings you're about to see, we still have to do geotechnical borings. We still have to do some site survey work. So you'll see the instruments out in the back here, and you'll see drilling rigs. We're not starting construction. We're just trying to see what's in the ground so that when we do our application, we're honestly telling the MBLC that the ground will support the building and that there's, you know, we didn't hit oil or something like that. Although if we hit oil, we'd be pretty happy we have a free library. But these are the next basically simplified three steps. Site geo, the OPM has gotten prices for site geo, geotech, and fortunately we've been able to marry a proposal with a neighboring town, so that we're going to do borings in the same day, so that you're halving the cost, because there aren't enough borings to do one whole day in Deerfield. There aren't enough to do one whole day in Irving. So, fortunately, both communities are going to be sharing the cost. So we're going to save some money there. The schematic design is pretty much what you're going to see today, but refined a little bit more and dimensioned and costed and things of that nature. And after we listen to what you have to say, it's really important. We want you to know this is community outreach for a reason. Ralph couldn't have hit it any better. We're guests. We build it and we're gone. This is your library. So we want to make sure we do it for you and you get what you want. Every library is a little bit different. They all have the same things, but they're all a little bit different. So that's where we are. We'll be applying for the construction grant application. You as a town meeting will vote to put the grant application in, and then you'll vote again to receive the grant when the funds are available.
Okay.
I apologize. I have to go to a meeting and hoping to make it back before we close.
So I didn't want to interrupt you anyway.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Slackman.
So one of the requirements of the grant is that we had to submit what's called a library building program to the Board of Library Commissioners. It had to be approved by the trustees and submitted to the Board of Library Commissioners and actually to our grant supervisor. So what went into the, I think of the library building program, it's not a program like what we think of as, you know, story time or a book discussion. It's really kind of an outline of what we want as a library. So what's in this document? This is it. There's a lot of things in this document, and a lot of people contributed to it. It starts out, there's a community description, so Deerfield is described in it. The library history, library governance, who rules the library, our services. There's a description of the existing library facility, room by room, so forth. And with that are the challenges and strengths that we have here in our library. And I'm sure that you can imagine what some of them are, and you probably know what some of our strengths are. We discuss library collections, which means like how many books we have and what type and what other parts of the collection we have, whether we have audiobooks or DVDs or videos. And then we go into trends and statistics, like our circulation and how many programs we have, how many library card holders, what the attendance at programs, our hours. We made a comparison of the number of hours that we are open compared to Greenfield and Sunderland. We made a comparison of the number of programs we have and the number of people who attend compared to other libraries of similar size in other libraries from towns of similar size. So all this went into this document, including a needs assessment, which wasn't just something that we cooked up from this survey that Judy mentioned. We have done a needs assessment from the long-range plan, which we did for 2014 to 2018. There were surveys done then. We had in-library surveys. We had a community survey, we had a library visioning exercise, and then the needs assessment committee did the survey at the election. And we also looked at standards for public library service. There's a set of guidelines called the Wisconsin standards that we look at. And so it's not just something I'm dreaming of, ooh, I'd like to have like 25 more bookshelves. We had to plug in all this information into these guidelines. So we came up with this. And why we did this before we hired anybody, before we hired the architect, and we presented it to the design firm. And the way I look at it is, if we were going to build a police station, the police chief and the people who work in the police station, they're not going to just say to the designer, we need a police station, design it for us. They, you know, we give them something, what you want. So this document tells the designer what the town of Deerfield wants. And we have copies of this, and you're always able to look at it. So that's the library building program.
And the next slide.
So we did this, and
here's your library.
He gave this to the designer, and this is what he came up with. And it isn't really how it's supposed to be, but as Julie said, these are the Lego blocks.
Yeah.
He found the Lego blocks for all the spaces that we required from our area descriptions here. So.
So.
Yep.
My turn?
You're up.
All right. My name's Phil O'Brien, and I get paid to play with clocks. That's what it sounds like, right? So we took the program and we translated it into that program diagram. And what it basically is, what it represents in pictures is really just exactly what's written in the program. Each of the spaces that's represented in the program is here, and they're all drawn to scale, they're all drawn to their proper size, and each one of them has the types of furnishings and equipment inside that space that's required to meet the program. So that all the books and materials that you need fit on the shelves that are shown here in the book stacks. The children's department has a desk and there's some computers and there's books for and materials for younger kids or older kids. And that gives us a way that we can kind of double check the program, because we're not supposed to mess with the program. You do want to hear from us in terms of feedback. We've done lots and lots of libraries, as Dan has mentioned. But we understand libraries in the abstract. We understand how libraries work. We understand how libraries function. But we need to know from you and from your committee and from you all what works best for you and your town. And that's one of the reasons that we're here tonight. We want to hear back from you how we're doing. So we have taken that program and we've translated it into a library diagram. So this is a composite site document, and it's got a couple of different things going on. This site plan that shows your site. There's your existing building, and we're down on the ground floor of this building here right now, and there's your little parking lot. So one of the things we look at is the site that you have right now large enough, and is it suitable enough to support a new library addition and renovations program? And yes, thankfully it is. A nice flat site. Got a nice downtown location. And so this is slightly turned, but there's your original building there again. And what we're basically showing is a library out to the rear. And a parking lot, pretty much where your parking lot is now, but a lot larger than the one is that you have right now to support the larger library design. And then if we take you inside a little bit, so it's a two-level plan. You've got a two-level building right now, and in order to accommodate the amount of square footage that we need to add onto the site, it makes the most sense to do a two-level addition. And so we have a two-story addition. At the lower level, you walk right in at the lower level here now. The way the building was originally built is essentially this lower level, what would have been considered the basement originally, was pretty much built on grade, and then the soil was kind of humped up along the front to kind of give that building that prominence. But the nice thing is that you can walk directly into the lower level, and so that's what we're suggesting, that the new main entrance is comes right into the lower level. So we're contemplating taking down the addition that was put on the side here that's got the stair and the small elevator in it, and remove that from this side, and have a new entrance that comes in right to the rear of the building, right off of the kind of the center of the new parking lot we're suggesting. When you come into the new building, and you come into a new lobby, there'll be an elevator that will take you up and a set of stairs out of this lobby space. You can get directly into the children's department, which is the large portion that you see in yellow in the rear of the building. It looks out towards the field from the back, and then a large meeting room that'll support a meeting like this, and we don't have to sit between the book stacks and so forth. And you can set that up for meetings, and you can set it up with tables and chairs, and there's a variety of different things you can set it up for, gallery space and so forth. And it's got some storage room for chairs, and it's got a little kitchenette. And then we've got some public toilets and so forth to support that. And then you could lock these inside doors right there. It's two sets of doors. If you lock those inside doors, these meeting room spaces can stay open in the evening when the rest of the library is closed, and you can have a meeting like this, and you don't have to worry about the material.
Community use after hours.
So that, not just for the library, but anybody that wants to use that space. So if you take the elevator, there's stairs up to the upper floor, basically at the same level as your existing building. So this is where your desk is right now, a little fireplace, and you come in the side door from the addition right in here now. And so we've got this book stack room. We've taken the book stacks out of there, and we've turned these really great rooms that you have up there into reading rooms. So we're trying to take advantage of that real nice space that we have up there that's so hard to recreate, and kind of turn them over to nice, comfortable reading spaces. And so we have a new circulation desk that's moved out to the center of the plan. We can kind of keep an eye on what's happening. And then in the rear part here, we've got new book stacks. There's a teams room, computers and reading spaces here in the center, a couple of quiet study or program rooms, and a couple of public toilets on the upper floor. Pretty simple all in all, but that's a plan for this proposed addition.
What's in the light brown on the ground floor in the front?
Right along in here, there's rooms in the back there. We're going to maintain one of those as a mechanical room. We've got electrical and mechanical rooms up in here. There's a staff room along in here that could also be used for meetings in the evening, which would be on this side of the building. And this guy right in here is the Friends book sale and sorting storage room.
And then there's the cafe area.
Right in the center of the plan, which kind of happens.
About where we are.
Kind of
be sip from a latte.
between those red columns and the doors over there. Is yeah, you can sip a latte.
Sip a latte without the radiators.
Oh, can I say one thing before we go further that we forgot to say? When we were doing the planning, we were looking ahead 20 years. So when we were coming up with the needs, when the Sarah's document and all of our talking and planning stuff was looking ahead 20 years. So this is not, that's another piece of what we've done so far is plan ahead.
When the new library opens, there'll actually be some empty shelves. And you'll go, why do we have empty shelves? Well, you have to, as part of the grant, designed for 20 years. And each year you're buying books, you'll be filling in those shelves. In the 20th year, there will be no shelves empty.
Can I say one thing about the upstairs or the main part of the library? We're planning, we're hoping to be able to keep the library upstairs the way it is now. The same moldings, the fireplaces and so forth. So our beloved old building, you know, still look the same up there.
And you hit on the main theme too. If you once you take the addition down, you're back to the original postcard. You're back to the original library, and the addition is set back and stepped back such that the prominence of the main building will be the main building.
Do you have an elevation
view? We do. We'll get there. Come on, patience. You guys are like kids. We are in the children's room.
How many books will the new library hold versus what the library currently holds?
Did you hear that question?
I did.
A lot.
I can't tell you, but I can tell you one thing, is that we will be able to have, right now, a lot of mysteries are written in series. We have the first copy of many series, and then we have maybe the last four or five. We'll be able to have a complete series of books. I do have the number in this building program that I can tell you after. I'll tell everybody after the meeting. I'll look it up and give you that.
Okay. One of the other things that we're required to do for the grant is to not look at this site. So we actually looked at another town site to take the library away from its current location.
Wait, we have to do the pros and cons first.
I'm getting to that. So we're going to give you the pros and cons of this site, and then we're going to go to the other site and give you the pros and cons. So when you see the pros and cons, you're not confused.
What's the capacity of the public meeting room?
I think it's 80 people. And actually, the adult fiction and nonfiction is 1,700 linear feet, sufficient to house and display 15,000 books, with space at the end of each of the middle shelves to display items face out. So that's just adult fiction and nonfiction. Right now, we have much less than that.
So for this first design, using the existing building, we came up with a list of pros and cons, and for both actually, but we're going to read this one first before we get into the design of the second site. So the pros, which may be somewhat obvious to people who live in the town, it's centrally located into the entire village of South Deerfield. It's in really easy walking distance to our schools. So the elementary school's kids, they can walk right from the back of, they don't even have to get on the road. Same for the frontier, they can walk on the sidewalk. So it's easily accessible as well as safe. It's also very easily accessible to the senior center, the town hall, and village businesses. It'll preserve, restore, and modernize one of the town's most historic buildings. Even though we would be adding on to the back of this existing library, if we went with this design, it would still retain enough outdoor land usage, because I know that's really important to us, because you know we have the summer music series, and you know the kids love to play outside here, and I think actually this design, a really important pro of it, is that it would actually kind of highlight that. It would make good outdoor spaces to kind of highlight how much we like to use the outdoor space for library programs. It adds to the visual character and community pride in the town. I think we all feel like, or I'll speak for myself, love the historic feel of the design of this building and love to be able to retain that. And the design does a really great job of integrating the old with the new and not giving up the character that we really love about this place. And also expands parking. So those are the pros.
Thank you, Candace Bradbury Carlin. We were supposed to introduce ourselves.
Oh. You're welcome. Satu Zoller.
I'm Satu Zoller. I'm on the trustees and also on this committee, and I've been asked to discuss the cons. And as you see, there's not too many cons that we could think of for this site. One was that it's multi-floor, and I guess the ideal is to have everything on one floor for accessibility reasons and other reasons. Another con would be that it's an older building, so renovating could come up with some problems in that. And that it does reduce some green space towards the back and through the expanded parking.
So this is the second site we were given to take a peek at. This is on Braeburn Road, which is a dead end street, kind of across the road from here. And this slide, there's a lot on this slide, sorry, but the library, where we are, is right here, right? And Braeburn is this dead end street that runs down around the back, and I guess the town owns a piece of property that's landlocked back out in here. Along in the town owns another piece of property that has a little sliver that comes down along just before the last house on the left. And so the idea was that we have to create a new driveway that runs through that piece of property and then back to this piece of property. And so this is the library site that we were given at to take another peek at, and we can go over the pros and cons. But obviously one of the issues there is it's a little hard to get to, and it would put an awful lot of traffic onto Braeburn Road, which wasn't really the plan for it. It's an open field, and there's plenty of room there. And so we designed a one-story building there, and I'll walk you through that. So in terms of layout, we've got a one-story plan. All of these colored blocks match my little Lego blocks from the other things. We just got to put them together in a different design, and parking right out in the front. And so you drive in, and there'd be plenty of parking right, and then go right into the main entrance. Once you get into the main entrance, this is really kind of built up along a spine that has a lot of the kind of reading spaces, popular materials, and books in the center. It's kind of that living room of the community. We're kind of trying to replicate the spaces that we have upstairs in this building. Circulation desk that kind of sits here in the middle of the plan where somebody can keep an eye on what's going on inside the building. That circulation desk is backed up by the workroom, staff spaces, and offices in the beige here. Right across the way here is the entrance to the children's department. And the children's department is in yellow. The children's desk and office there. And then there's the teens department here, shown in orange. And then we've got local history and other quiet study spaces along in there, those kind of quieter reading spaces that are tucked off to the side, periodicals down at the back of the room, book stacks are in here. And then on this side, we've got that large meeting room with the kitchen, the storage room, and the toilets. And again, that could be locked off in the evening and used at night. It's a separate wing.
Where's the latte?
That happens right out here near the front door.
So pros.
Candace.
I'm Candace from, you don't miss that. We'll still have lattes. So it will be a brand new building, and a new site, and a new HVAC system, which is good. Everything on one story, which is a positive for people with disabilities or just getting around from room to room. There's more design options, especially if you want to expand it in the future after we do this initial design. If you want to expand it, you could do that easily on this site.
And we did actually find several cons, things that don't bode well for this site, including that the road is very narrow, as was just mentioned, and so vehicle access is going to be difficult on that road. It wouldn't be visible from the main street of town, which we were told might actually hurt our chances of receiving the grant. It's not a historic building, obviously, because it's brand new. It wouldn't have the presence or connection that this library has with the rest of the town, with the schools and other parts of town, and that it might mean redefining a residential street.
The Library Board of Library Commissioners does strongly encourage that the building be easily visible. If you think about it, in every little town in Massachusetts, you drive by, you see the library. Mm-hmm. Judy?
This is back to the first design. So here's the old building right here, the current building. And this all glass in sort of section that joins the two parts. And as Candace was talking about before, in terms of the outside space, you'd be able to see right through to the space over in there. And if you were coming to do something out there, you'd just be very well integrated. And then this is the new addition.
How much of in that image you were of the glass in area? How much of that image is currently taken up by the elevator and the addition that's here now?
None. The elevator and the addition are here.
You're talking about that.
These two windows. These two windows don't exist.
Well, they do.
Well, they do. The openings exist.
And they still, they're in the back.
And they're in the back here.
Wait, I don't know if we're getting this question right. You're talking about the new elevator or the current elevator?
The addition that is currently on this building.
Yes.
Right over right. there.
That all gets torn down. That's all.
I understand that that's okay. the proposal. What yep. I'm asking is okay. how much of the space that yes. is glassed in, right. as we're looking at that,
right.
is currently occupied by the addition that's being proposed to be torn down.
No, the glass would be right through that window.
Imagine that cube, as we call it, the cube for accessibility is here.
Yeah. We're looking at the side.
Right? So your current addition that you came in is over here right now.
It's gone.
And we're going to take that down. And so that comes out like this. And so the new proposal would come off of the back of that.
And where's the elevator on that new section?
On the new one, the elevator is here.
So it's inside where that
right
first...
Right there, see the little green lock?
Yeah, that green
it's
lock
actually
that pokes
the
up the roof. Right, that's the over travel of the penthouse for the elevator poking through the roof.
So, yes, questions, yes?
I do appreciate that you're trying to maintain an architectural consistency between the two buildings. Uh-huh. Because of the north-south orientation of both buildings, what does that do to the potential for solar power arrays on the roof?
There is still a potential for panels on the roof. Obviously, the ones that face straight south are going to be the best. Can we go back to that slide?
Sure.
The site plan.
I'm sorry, site plan?
The site plan. This one. That one. Okay? So that shows north is not really straight up and down on Main Street. This one's pretty close to straight up and down. And right. so the south side of the building is really here. We're on a funny angle. We're not really east-west. And so we can get some panels on the slope facing side of the new addition out the back, so they won't face the street, and the existing building will kind of block that from the road, right. So you don't have that thing, those kind of modern shiny panels looking at you, but we can still get quite a bit on that panel, on that section of the roof.
Anybody else? Just even if you don't have a question, just a reaction. Yes.
I was just curious, what was the thought that would happen to the old building if you went with the new one?
We didn't really go there. It would be up for the town to decide, you know, what to do with it.
I was wondering who it actually belongs to.
It belongs to the town.
It does?
Yeah. Definitely. Chair?
Is solar actually being part of the new division?
We haven't actually put that into the plan. I think that's something that we could go back and, you know, since we're going to be tweaking the plans, we could have some discussion with the designers about what exactly that would mean. And then, of course, you know, you have to figure out the cost, how much more you're adding in cost and how much you would recoup. And so there's a lot of calculations to be done, but we have not thought about that.
There are calculations related to that, but it's also encouraged. The town gets a grant bonus if you get LEED silver, and you get a bigger grant bonus if you get LEED gold, and a bigger grant bonus. if you get LEED Platinum. To get to LEED Gold, you're going to have some sort of power generating on the roof to get the points to get to the gold level. There's a big giant checklist that we go through, insulating factors, efficiency of heating systems, where the materials come from. If they're local, you get points because you're not creating carbon to deliver it across country, things of that nature. Reusing an old building, we get points for reusing this building. So there are things that we'll be looking at in the next phase, not in this phase, but the building has the capability, as the designer said, to put the panels on that whole backside.
So the what I heard about the adding the solar panels to the southward facing new part of the addition did not sound like a part and parcel of a plan from the beginning, like maybe it wasn't quite enough to actually run the whole library.
Oh, no.
It won't be enough to run the whole library. So even if we covered that entire roof, it wouldn't be enough to run the whole library.
Well, I was going to suggest that although Mark over there had said that it was really, he appreciated how you had integrated the new with the old, maybe sometimes we can frankly change the angles and decide this is a frankly modern building that we're putting onto the back. We're not pretending that it's part of the old, and turn the building at an angle and give us more roof so we get more sun or something, mm-hmm. just to free up. I mean, you might consider that as a whole option, to free up and not do the thing that Mark appreciated so much, which I also appreciate.
Yes?
My question is, will this, the funding agency for this project require Mass Historic approval of the addition?
Yes.
And when will that be done?
You actually have to, there's a two-page standard form that Mass Historic has that needs to be filled out, sent in prior to the application.
With the plans, right?
So once we're at the final schematic design, once you all are happy with what we've done, once we get to that point, then we'll submit it to Mass Historic and fill out that form.
Yes. Again?
Yep, sure. Don't forget also to have an okay of the archaeological probing that you're going to have to do before you do any building there, and check with the Deerfield Historical Commission.
Just a general reaction to this proposal. First, I want to say thank you. This is hugely exciting, and this, even without seeing the other, brand new one-level proposal, this seems very compelling to me, and I love the list of pros that came up for this site, and I really agree with those pros. And for me to even consider the other site, I would want to know what the town plan is for this, because frankly, nothing is more pathetic than when these beautiful old buildings are just left empty and nothing happens with them. So I don't know if that's something that would be built into the process, that before, it went to a vote or something, there would at least, the public would be able to know what is the plan. But this looks great to me, and I'm really excited about it.
One of the results of all the surveys that we did was that I don't think anybody mentioned anything about building a new library that was it seems to me that the people who responded to our questions would like this building to remain as a library. So I don't think we're at the point where we're even thinking about what we would do with this building if it wasn't a library. But I understand what you're saying.
Yes?
In response to what Jane was asking a minute ago about whether the solar piece, how that could fit in, and whether the orientation of the building could be changed, and whether the design could be more modern and not necessarily in sync with the historical character of the current building. Is that something that is even possible? I mean, considering that it's a historic building, quote unquote,
Mass Historic is, I mean, I can't speak for Mass Historic, but we have done a lot of historic restoration work, and as you can imagine, we've done a lot of libraries, and a lot of libraries are older buildings. Mass Historic is going to be looking at this as they would look at anything else, with an eye towards the Secretary of the Interior's treatment for historic properties. That's their guideline. And the guidelines there for adding on to historic buildings are to do buildings that aren't an exact copy, but are sympathetic, is what they're going to be looking for. Now, how you define sympathetic is completely up to the person that's reviewing the design at the time that we send it in. And so you could make it a little bit more modern. In other words, if it looked a lot like it does right now, but we just cranked it a little bit, or if we had some of the same proportions and we still made it out of masonry, but the windows were square and didn't have these little round things, they'd probably still approve that. Because I think you could make a case that it's sympathetic. But this one does pick up more of its cues in terms of the parapeted walls and the gables and the ends and the little chimneyettes at the ends of the gables and so forth. We have picked up more of the clues from this existing building, only because the building is not very big. And to do something kind of completely different around the back seemed like a kind of too much of a departure. But is it possible? Sure. But I can't tell you whether they'd say okay or not. I think they would say okay to this. But, you know, if we went a little further, I it's hard for me to say.
I think a glass cube coming off the back of this building is a little inappropriate given the historic structure and architecture of what we have in the front. I think it would be a little...
No glass cube,
but in keeping with the form and structure of the front of the building, I think to keep it as architecturally sympathetic to what we have in the front would probably do us a better shot with the Historic Commission.
It's
something.
Beautiful.
You're not talking about this glass.
No. I like the fact that it flows.
Right.
Yes.
From front to back.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
With a little glass sandwich piece in the middle.
Yep.
It's very uniform, the way it's been presented.
Yes, over there.
Yep. I know that you haven't even gone this far yet in terms of energy planning, but I just want to point out that because the town owns the field behind you. My understanding is it would not be out of the question to put a horizontal array geothermal under the baseball field. And, you know, a lot of the cost of geothermal is drilling vertical wells, but when you can do it horizontally, you save a lot of money. And it's town-owned land. There's no, you know, there's no conflict in use. And the geothermal could cut the energy bill by 25%.
And get us lead points.
Absolutely. Yeah, so I'm saying don't limit your thinking to just because this is the parcel that's owned by the library when your adjacent parcel is essentially owned by the town.
When the grant is awarded, the next phase of this project is design development. And in design development, we start talking about the structure. What is the structure? What are the systems? HVAC systems, energy systems, all those systems get discussed and vetted out. We're not just going to throw gas units on the roof and say, look to you, we got an HVAC system. Libraries are a little different. They want to be quiet. So geothermal works. I mean, a lot of things work. So we'll go through that exercise when the time comes.
Yes?
Yeah. Hopefully I'm not getting too far ahead of you, but I'm curious about the exterior and the grounds around it, and what will be gained and what will be lost in terms of how many feet back you're going toward the baseball field. Will we lose both trees back there or one tree?
I think we were thinking about those trees, and I think it was one tree. And then, of course, there'd be a parking lot between us and the church.
Right.
So
I'm just curious how many feet that amounts to. Just ballpark.
I could. They're going to get the slide. They can tell you a few, but I can tell you visually.
Yeah.
It's pretty close to the edge back there, and then on the side here, the parking lot would you know, this whole space between us and the church belongs to the town. And so that would all
be
part of
it.
So, yeah, it's in the streets, right?
Again, the parking stuff is part of what they require. So you have to have a certain number of parking spaces for these, the space you have in the building. So we have to add this parking lot on.
Right, so you can see it's a winter picture. You can see there's two trees here. There's another one along there. But these are going to be fine. That one's okay. This one, I think, probably going to lose. We're just going to be into it too much. Too many of the roots are going to be damaged.
And it'll be real close to the building after it's buildings up.
And we kind of put things in danger. One more slide.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, you can kind of see. So that tree stays. This one is really right in there.
I just want to say the committee was very concerned about the trees, making sure we did everything we could.
We did actually try to look. We did look at a scheme that took the addition and squished it down this way and spread it out.
Right.
It didn't really work. It looked a little funny, but it actually didn't work very nice.
Well, we did have a tree meeting.
We did talk about trees.
Good.
Yes. What's happening with the front entrance?
Good question.
That's a great question.
All entrances are required to be accessible. Although you can get exceptions. And what our architects are telling us is that this front entrance is not going to be an approved entrance.
Right.
The main entrance will be the side entrance. Once they're gone, whatever we do with the front entrance is up to us. So, and besides which, we may be able to continue. I think, Sarah, we could continue with, because we already have an exception for the front entrance, and so that might be continued. So it's our hope as the committee that the front entrance would remain a front entrance.
I see. Can you go in there now?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah.
Well, not at the moment because of the snow, but yeah. The snow's not there. Oh, yes.
Yes or no?
Oh, I see.
The front door our main entrance is here. We may use this as an entrance, but we don't use it in the winter because of the condition of the. We just don't. We decided it was a better thing not to.
Yeah, I have another question. So it seems like from what I've heard is that the grant would provide 50% at most of construction?
You can get a little bit higher depending on the lead number you get, but 50% is an accurate number, and of course we'll be to the penny when the time comes, but 50% is roughly about what you'll get and what you should think in the back of your mind you're going to get.
So have you thought about how the other, let's say it's 50% we get from the grant, how the other 50% is going to be funded? Would it be CPA money? Would it be a town override?
Well, some of it would come from the town, the bulk of it, and then perhaps Dave from the trustees could talk about what the trustees are going to be doing with their capital contribution program, right?
Yeah, so we're still early in the planning, but we're talking about putting together a fundraising committee and raising money from private sources in addition to what we might ask the town for. We obviously want to raise as much as we possibly can from private sources.
Could you use CPA money for this?
You could use CPA money for this building here, for sure.
Oh, from existing building.
Yeah, absolutely.
But not for the
they've already helped us out a lot.
I don't think so.
As you may know.
Yes.
And that would probably be one of the sources we would go to as well.
There was another question. Yes, in the back.
A question from the architect.
Yeah.
Are there any examples of work you've done in this area?
Yes. I'm so glad you've asked.
Yeah.
They're like my children.
The good ones.
The good ones.
All right.
All right. I won't tell you about that. No, I'll tell you about all of them. We did the new library in Sunderland. We did the new library in Leverett. We did the addition and renovation at the Springfield branch library. One of the branch libraries down there, 16 acres. We did the East Longmeadow Public Library. That's right in downtown.
South Hadley.
We did the new South Hadley Public Library. Thank you.
Look at that.
On the river.
You must not like that child.
Yeah, you told me only the good ones.
We did the
addition renovation of the Great Barrington.
Yeah, Great Barrington is, I think, similar to ours in that they have an old building that was preserved with an addition on it, whereas Sunderland is an entirely new building.
I guess one of the things that I would like to point out...
That's probably it for close by.
Buildings that they have designed. If you've ever seen Leverett and Sunderland, they're not cookie-cutter libraries. They kind of go with that, with the town. They're all unique.
Just while we're on that fiscal part, are we talking a total construction budget of $1 million or $2 million, do you suppose?
We have a total construction budget of unknown, as we're not that far along to give you a number. And if we gave you a number, that number would stick in your head till you expire. So what we want to do is do it correct. The architect's going to do an estimate. The OPM's going to do an estimate. We're going to combine the estimates, and we're going to have a general idea of where we are.
When we get some actual numbers to look at, then we'll come back to the community and tell people what those numbers are. But at the moment, we can't even project what the numbers are because we're still trying to figure out what it is that we want. So we're still in that stage.
We do have some square footage estimates that we can talk about, right, Phil?
Kind of comparative estimates, you mean? I don't know what I would do. I'd have to try to do the math for you. Square footage estimates are an interesting kind of rule of thumb. And so you could take the square footage of the new construction on this building, and then we'd have to come up with another number for the square foot cost of the renovations.
I'm not talking about cost, just the total square footage of the new project, or the total project.
Oh, the total. Well, we're looking at a building that's about 12,500 square feet total, is what the new building is.
And what is this building square footage, roughly?
It's about a third of that.
I mean, you can sort of see that just by looking at the page. There's the current building.
You had your hand up forever and a day.
The actual numbers, if you're interested,
are
written here.
The buildings that Stuart did in Northfield, in addition to the library?
It's a very small, it's a library, but we didn't do very much library space there. It's a new and accessible entrance. If anybody knows the building, it's a pretty little building, similar to yours, kind of a little block instead of brick. It's made out of granite. And we designed an addition that is almost the same size as that building right across the back in three structural bays. And what they decided to do is not do two of those structural bays, and so we put one of them on. And so there's a void in the back there where someday they're going to come along and fill in the other parts there and kind of fill that out and get some more space for their library book stacks and so forth. So in that one little bay is an exit stair, an elevator, an accessible entrance, and a couple of toilets. That's what's in there. And it basically allows them to kind of clear out some of that stuff out of the existing building and kind of reorganize them a little bit. We did that about 10 years ago.
On the right side there with the green circle in red, is that planned outdoor space for us to access from the library?
Yes, that's right. So there are doors that come in from this side, and then there are doors that exit out, as well as doors that exit out to the lawn in the rear, but there are doors that come right out of the lobby onto this side here.
Anybody else have any thoughts? Yes.
Any plans for landscaping in the back?
Eventually, yes. We haven't gotten to that point yet. But I think that as a number of people have said, we do use the outdoor space in the summer, and part of designing the central the central unifying piece was so that you could go straight through, so that you that side of the building would be, or the outside space would be connected to this side of the outside space. Mm-hmm. And there's a door out the back from the children's room and in terms of the actual landscape design, we haven't got to that stage yet. Yes?
Have you looked at facade alternate treatments other than brick in the new addition?
We haven't at this point, no.
but you will.
Yeah, well, the, I mean, you've got an existing brick building, and brick is pretty low maintenance, and so that's why we gravitated to that. It's a little bit more expensive, but the upfront costs on a masonry facade, you know, we're not, these, all, you know, these are brick walls that are solid brick, and we don't build brick buildings like that anymore for the most part. There'll be one layer of brick that gets backed up on a steel stud system. So it's not too expensive. But in terms of its wear and tear and its durability, it really does last. So.
I know brick buildings are sometimes not well insulated. I don't know if this building has been updated. If it hasn't, would the proper insulation of this building be included in the project?
That's a good question. There are some things we can do with an old, what's called mass masonry building, but there are some things you really can't do to a building like this because of the way it's designed. So we can do things like tighten the windows and other openings in the building, like the doors. We can insulate up in the roof. It's really hard to add insulation on the inside of masonry walls like that because of the way that they react to the weather. If you think about it, the way that a masonry wall acts is that it's kind of cold on the outside and warm on the inside in the wintertime, and the water vapor kind of moves back and forth through that wall at all different seasons, and the dew point where the water vapor turns back into water kind of moves back and forth inside the wall. And once you put that insulation on there, you've taken the wall that's really spent most of its life on the outside in the weather, and most of it's on the inside of the brick is on the inside where it's warm all the time. And as soon as you put the insulation on the inside, you're taking all that brick and really pushing it to the outside of the heated envelope. And so now you have all of your brick is now out in the weather all the time. And it's into the freeze-thaw cycles, which has never been before. And so you can add water problems and actually crumbling structural problems over the long term with a masonry building like this. So there's some things that we can do pretty easily. And actually, most of your heat loss in this building is probably out through the roof. And in the windows. Mass masonry is actually pretty good as an insulator, just because there's so much masonry there.
This room holds the heat nicely. The windows were redone, as far as I can tell. And I never complain about being cold, ever.
It is a nice room.
I stopped wearing wool.
Yes?
My understanding, and I may be incorrect on this, is that new construction for places of assembly have to be constructed to meet seismic stresses?
That's right.
Would that also apply to this older existing building?
No. When you do an addition renovation onto a building like this, the existing portions of the building are under a different part of the building code, on Chapter 34, for existing buildings. And written, there are certain triggers that would mean you would need to take this building up to seismic. Now, for example, if we decided that it would be great if we could have real good connectivity out the back of the building, so we're going to tear up a whole back masonry wall, that would be a problem, because then you'd have to make this building seismically sound, and it would be cost prohibitive, really.
Yes, okay.
So now, following up on your very good explanation of what happens to the brick and the heat,
mm-hmm.
What's going to happen to the back of this building that adjoins the glassed-in center section that is now going to be indoors?
That's right, and it won't be subject to the freeze-thaw cycles anymore.
So what will... Oh, right. It won't be inside or outside.
It'll stabilize. We'll point it up, and then it should stabilize. And then when you come around, you have to repoint the outside of the building. You won't have to repoint the part that's inside anymore, because it'll be stable.
Got it.
Sounds
good.
I don't think anyone said this, but it's really beautiful.
So
now he's gonna have a big head at the next meeting.
We're happy to answer individual questions, and you know, please take some things with some goodies with you as you leave, Dave.
I just wanted to say before you all go, one of our really most important fundraising events is coming up shortly. This has nothing to do with the library edition. It's an annual thing that we've been doing now for 7 or 8 years, which is our wine and microbrew tasting. And this is going to take place on the bookmarks out on the refreshment table, which announce it.
March 9th.
Wednesday, March 9th, from 6 to 8 at Chandler's Tavern. the spirit shop here in town is putting together all the wine suppliers, and I get work on getting beer suppliers. We're having local craft breweries, cider people from Wheeler Farms, and Green River Ambrosia Wines. The over 40 different wines from around the world to taste. And just wanted to let you know.
The tickets are $20 in advance and $25 at the door. So you can buy tickets here or from any of the friends.
Good job.
Please come.
So I just wanted to tell you that the pictures that you saw here of the plans and the exterior and that sort of thing, we can post those. We plan to post them on the library website in as soon as possible, and we can also put them on Facebook. So you can see, if you didn't get to see from where you're sitting, they'll be available for close-up examination.
Get that iPad and spread.
Is the program report on PDF available online?
The building program?
It can be put on the website. Yep, that's a good idea.
Oh, one last question. What I see some green lines in parts of the parking lot. Are those your versions of shrubs, or are those green walls? Or
shrubs,
are those, what are those?
They were shrubbery.
So just green lines.
Well, somebody asked about landscaping, so that sort of fits into that question.
At one point, they were really sculpting, you know, perfectly square.
What you're looking at in the plan is the overhead view of this poor attempt of landscaping in a modeling program. We're trying to get you some more natural looking plant material.
There'll be plants in there, what you're saying.
Yeah. It's one of those things.
It really looks like Lego there.
The highway department would love for it to just be a big sheet of pavement because it's easy to plow, right? But it's really not, it's not nice to be at. It's hard to deal with the changes in the grade. And we'll probably have some trees in here as well to provide some shade. Just so we can reduce the heat island effect of that.
In that same development of the design, we'll be looking at systems on how to deal with rainwater. Do we have rain gardens? Do we have subsurface drainage? Can we have subsurface drainage? All of those questions will get answered in design development. And almost always, we try to do rain gardens because it's the environmentally sound thing to do, and they're not high maintenance. And you know, they purify the water before it goes back to the earth.
And there's no standing water, which is a public health issue.
Right.
I would just like to recommend that along with beautiful trees and shrubbery and everything, the landscaping, you have an opportunity there on the same property, on the parking lot, facing the sidewalk, to actually see if you can get allowance to put up some kind of structure that has a community information bulletin board that belongs to the library and can be something that attracts people to that spot. So an architectural detail that picks up all those details that you did so well in picking up on the additional building, also on in front of the parking lot.
This is a bus route.
We do, of course, there's this one here, and I think it was envisioned that in this lobby area where the lattes are.
Outside.
Yeah, I know, but there would also be this space.
Yeah, I got it, but outside.
Okay, well, we'll put that at the top. Yes, sir.
Is there any proposed exterior lighting, parking lot lighting, pedestrian lighting?
There will be.
I don't know what the answer to that is. We probably will have it, but I couldn't tell you what it is at this point. It's too early.
Design development.
Yep.
To the north side of the building, is a perm copy of the side, the south side there?
Almost. It's very close. It's building, it's pretty symmetrical based on the symmetry of the original building.
You plan on having glass on that side as well? Or?
Yeah, this idea of this glass link is to kind of make a soft connection to the back of this building here so that we don't have any hard lines with the masonry kind of crashing into the back. So we are contemplating having glass on the opposite side as well. Yep.
Sure.
Big tree right outside the door, is that going to stay?
I think that is going to stay. I think that's
that's kind of what we're trying to show right here.
Okay.
Yeah.
I just thought it was working.
Yeah, no, it's a nice tree. Okay, well, thank you all very much for coming. And
thank you.
Glad to see you.
Thank you.
What?
I think you're running off.